too, hurry. Our new guests are arriving.
You're always so happy every time they come.
Well, why not? They pay a lot of money for a weekend visit.
Not all of them pay a lot of money.
Don't be mercenary, Tatu. I only cut the price when I find the fantasies particularly intriguing, or when I feel a personal sympathy for them. Then I think it's only fair that they pay only what they can afford.
Because you just enjoy making their fantasies come true?
Precisely.
And I'm the Easter Bunny. You enjoy it more when fantasies don't turn out to be what the people expect.
Perhaps. But you know, we are such stuff as dreams are made of.
Hemingway.
Close. Shakespeare. Smiles. Smiles, everyone. We want our guests to feel welcome. Music, Tatu. Miss Margot Dean. Does that name mean anything to you?
Lipstick,
facial creams, eyeshadows. The exclusive Margot Dean line of cosmetics in person.
She's rich, then. She can afford to pay the full price for a weekend here.
Ah, yes, Tatu. Miss Dean could well afford the price of a weekend. That is, if she knew she was here for a fantasy. Lowell Benson, second in command at Margot Dean Enterprises. But she's definitely the boss, Tatu, and don't you forget it. Huh? Mr. and Mrs. Faber. Brian Faber is a moderately successful lawyer. His wife, Lucy, is president of the Children's Aid Society in Santa Barbara. Unfortunately, the Fabers have no children themselves.
And not much money either, I bet.
Oh, be quiet, Tatu. Janet Fleming.
A very lovely lady.
Lovely and lost.
Lost?
She doesn't even know who she is or where she is. That's why Janet has come to Fantasy Island, to try to find herself. Charles Fleming, corporate attorney and Janet's husband.
Her husband? But she looked at him like she didn't know him.
She doesn't.
What? But how can she be married to a total stranger?
They are not strangers, Tatu. On the contrary, it's their anniversary. They were married 4 years ago today. After the wedding, they went off to Charles Fleming's house in the country for the honeymoon. And there...
Yes, yes, what happened?
What happened indeed. Dear guests, I am Mr. Rourke, your host. Welcome to Fantasy Island.
Excuse me, Mr. Rourke. I believe a Mr. Roy Maxwell is expecting me.
Oh, yes, Miss Dean, I should have told you before. Mr. Maxwell asked me to express his sincere apologies for not meeting your plane.
I traveled halfway around the world and he's not here.
Oh, don't be alarmed. He's just over the other side of the island. He asked that you meet him there.
I see. How do we get to the other side of the island?
Oh, I'll take you there myself, Miss Dean. It's just a short trip by boat.
You'll have to excuse me if I'm a little impatient. This meeting with Mr. Maxwell is extremely important to me.
Shall we say an hour? I thought perhaps you might like to change after your flight. I made a bungalow available for you, Miss Dean.
Thank you. Yes, a shower would be nice.
Tattoo.
You know, Benson, if I can pull off this merger with Roy Maxwell this weekend, it will change my entire life. I don't want anything to get in the way of that.
Show Miss Dean to her bungalow, will you?
Can you believe it?
That beautiful, and all she can do is eat, sleep, and think business deals 24 hours a day.
That's life, Mr. Benson.
I guess I should go change my clothes, too.
Aki will show you to your room. Mr. and Mrs. Faber, I hope you enjoyed your flight.
Oh, yes, it was very nice.
Thank you, yes.
Where is she? Did you find her?
Of course I found her. That's my job. And my main pleasure in life, to grant other people's wishes.
When can we see her?
I'll take you to her now.
Oh, good.
This way, please.
It's so strange. I don't even know her name. What is it?
Why not let her tell you that herself, huh?
I still can't quite believe it. For the last 12 years, there hasn't been a day I haven't thought about her, worried if she was all right.
You've had nothing to worry about. The couple who adopted your daughter have taken very good care of her. She's a fine girl.
What does she know about us?
She doesn't know anything. She's probably been told that you were young and married, that you couldn't afford to give her the kind of home and life you wanted her to have.
I didn't know then that I'd never be able to have another child.
I see. Did you ever think of adopting a child yourselves?
You know, we've thought about it many times, but Lucy could never quite bring herself.
I can't. I don't know it. It would seem like an exchange. Exchanging our own child for a stranger.
But then life is nothing but exchanges, isn't it? Will you get in, please? Before you meet your daughter, I must remind you of the one condition you have already agreed to.
That we can't tell her we're her real parents?
Precisely.
I know we agreed to that before we came, but who does she think we are?
Oh, your daughter was invited here to Fantasy Island for a weekend holiday. Now, that's all she's been told. You are the couple who will be looking after her to see that she has a good time. You do still agree to my conditions, don't you?
If I don't?
Then I assure you that you'll go back to the plane without seeing her.
You don't leave me any choice.
That's the prerogative of having your own island, isn't it? Well?
I agree, Mr. Wood.
Mr. Faber.
Yes. Yes, obviously, if she's happy in her present life.
Well, that you would have a whole weekend to find out about, won't you?
But tell me.
Sorry. I'm afraid I decided it would be better if you didn't know.
What kind of trick is this?
No trick, Mrs. Faber. I only want to make sure that neither you nor the child will be hurt.
I wouldn't hurt her for anything in the world.
Good. Then please remember your promise. And if you do find out which one is your daughter, you are not to tell her who you are.
We've already agreed to that several times.
It's all right, Brian. Mr. Rourke, do you think I won't know my own child? I'll know her the moment I meet her.
Your fantasy come true? Come along then, I'll introduce you.
This is Mr. and Mrs. Faber, the couple I told you about. They are here to see you all have a very good time together. Pat?
Hi.
Carol?
Hello.
Anne?
How do you do?
Very well, thank you.
Dusty, you promised we could ride through the surf. Is it okay?
Sure. Just be careful.
We will. See you later.
Well, if you'll excuse me, I have other guests. Have a nice week.
I... Carol? Anne? I don't know. I just don't know.
But you can bet I'll find out which one is our daughter.
I'm afraid you've been brought here under false pretenses, Miss Ian. Mr. Maxwell isn't here.
What?
No, 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 please, please, don't interrupt me. As you know, you are on Fantasy Island. What you probably don't know is that this is the place to which people come to realize their secret wishes. For a few days, for a prize. You are here because Mr. Benson has paid a great deal of money, a great deal for him, to be alone with you for the weekend. Not in an office or a boardroom, but on the more natural, more primitive conditions. You are here to fulfill Mr. Benson's fantasy.
This is outrageous!
Yes, I was afraid you'd see it that way.
All right, gentlemen, we may go.
Wait, where are you going? You can't leave me here.
Oh, I'm afraid I can.
This is insane. How much did he pay you? I'll double it. I'll triple it!
Sorry, Miss Dean, I don't accept bribes.
My clothes! My things!
Don't worry, I take care of it.
Gentlemen?
As the man said, welcome to Fantasy Island. Disappointed about Roy Maxwell. I'm sorry about that. It's the only way I could think of to get you here.
If it weren't so absurd, it would be almost funny. You.
Try not to be angry, Margot. I hope you don't mind if I call you Margot.
Oh, I suppose that's part of your fantasy, Benson. Instant familiarity.
My first name is Lowell.
Yes, I know. Benson. I've been signing your salary checks for years.
Yes, and for years I've been thinking about you. The real you, Margot. The one you try to keep hidden. The Margot Dean without the business computer for a heart.
How touching. I'll bet when you were a little boy, you kept dirty pictures hidden under your mattress.
I see, my mother told you.
There's something you didn't plan on when you arranged to get me here, Benson. I'm not going to play. I'm not going to spend the weekend with you. I'm not going to spend another minute with you.
You don't seem to understand. You don't have a choice.
Oh, but I do. I'm going back to that seaplane. Back to New York. And stop calling me Margot.
Here, I brought these for you. Insect repellent, suntan lotion, toothpaste, toothbrush. You might need them.
The perfect employee. Goodbye, Benson. Oh, and incidentally, in case you haven't guessed, you're fired.
It's that way. It's west. 12 miles across the jungle and then over the mountains.
Well, don't worry about me. I got all the way from the dirt of West Virginia to my own office in the World Trade Center. I'll make it.
Taking Janet.
She's resting, Mr. Fleming. Trust me, everything is ready for you.
Except that I've changed my mind. I'm not going any further with it.
Now, you were at the meeting at Lakedale Sanitarium when Dr. Croydon and the other psychiatrists discussed Janet's wish to relive the past. Now, why did you agree to this experiment then?
Experiment? It's a piece of barbaric cruelty. Like the old medieval custom of throwing the patient into a snake pit. Trying to scare Janet back to her senses.
That's not what you said at the meeting.
How do you know? You weren't there.
Wasn't I? We both know you agreed to Janet's wishes, Mr. Fleming. Were you afraid to raise any objections to the doctors at Lakedale? Huh? Afraid how it might look? A husband with complete control of his wife's money. A control you might lose if Janet were to be cured.
Mr. Rourke, I want Janet back the way she was. I loved her then and I love her now, but this isn't the way
if
to treat...
If you love her, help her. Dr. Croydon thinks Janet may be right. To relive her honeymoon, to find out what happened 4 years ago, what made her close off her mind, all past memory. That may well be Janet's only chance of recovery.
To put her through all that terror again.
Everything is ready, Mr. Fleming. Your house, everything is exactly as it was the day of your wedding.
What about the others? Are they here?
I said exactly, didn't I? As happened 4 years ago, you will begin your honeymoon at your old family home.
Pierre, darling, don't you?
Congratulations, Mrs. Fleming. I look after the garden, Mrs. Fleming. And things that need doing around the house.
I'm sorry. Dr. Croydon says it helps to remember people if I touch them.
Of course, darling. I'll bring in the luggage. Mr. Fleming.
Welcome back, Mr. Charles. It's nice having you home. And you too, Mrs. Fleming.
Grant. We hope you'll both be very happy.
Were you both here last time I came here?
We've worked for Mr. Charles's family since he was a young boy.
I expect you are very tired after such a long journey. May I show you to your room?
Yes.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? Really extraordinary. Everything exactly as it was on our honeymoon.
My wife and I simply couldn't believe it, sir, when we first saw it.
It's like suddenly going back in time, 4 years ago. Even Pierre.
Mr. O'Rourke is a regular magician, sir. Reconstruct everything. Recreating the whole thing right here on this island.
Yes. Oh, it was kind of you and Mrs. Grant to agree to come. I know it must be difficult for you having to live through it all again.
We're very happy, sir, to do anything to help Mrs. Fleming.
Thank you, Grant.
Oh, excuse me, sir. When Mrs. Fleming was unpacking upstairs, you went into the drawing room. There was some mail waiting for that.
Oh, yes, I remember. Yes, you're right, Grant. We should all try to do exactly as we did then.
I announced dinner at 7:30.
Didn't you even open it? Rosemary's letter.
No.
Didn't you read it?
No. What for?
I never took her threats seriously.
Well, you and Rosemary were very close for a time. Before you met Janet again.
It was just one of those infatuations that students go through. It was over months before I married Janet.
At least you could be sure even a cocktail waitress like Rosemary wasn't after your money. Studying law on the GI Bill, you didn't have anything except this old family house, and the bank would have taken that away from you if you hadn't been lucky enough to marry such a wealthy girl.
I told you I fell in love with Janet.
Suddenly, after knowing her since you were both children?
Goodbye, Mr. Rourke. Whatever I agreed to, it didn't include having you around on my honeymoon.
I'll only be around when I am needed, Mr. Fleming. Where are you going?
Upstairs to Janet. Upstairs when I heard Mrs. Fleming cry out.
We all sleeping in the same room?
Sure. Do you mind, Pat?
No. I sleep in the same room with my sister at home.
Your sister?
Well, she's adopted, too.
Oh, are you adopted, Anne?
It's weird, isn't it? We're all adopted.
We found out when we were talking on the plane.
Really? How old are you?
12.
Oh, that's a wonderful age, isn't it? When's your birthday?
April the 10th. We're all exactly the same age, too. The same birthday.
That's quite a coincidence.
It's creepy.
I don't think it is a coincidence. I think that's why we were invited here.
What do you mean?
Well, someone came around to all our schools and talked to us. It was supposed to be sort of a statewide competition to win a weekend on Fantasy Island.
They obviously just picked the three of us who were most alike.
I don't see we're all that much alike.
Well, come on out whenever you're ready, girls.
Oh, yeah. See you later.
Okay, bye.
Bye. Bye.
Rourke's obviously planned everything to make it impossible for us.
Maybe. But I think I know. I'm almost sure I know who she is.
Cut your foot?
My ankle. What do we do, chalk one up for your side?
No. But you better let me put a little antiseptic on it.
I can do it myself. What you're really after is revenge, isn't it? I mean, that's what this whole charade is about.
No. I never thought of it as revenge, Margot.
Why not? You must hate me. You must have hated me for years.
Why should I?
Don't all men hate their bosses? Especially when she's a woman.
Some might.
Any man with any guts.
There might be some things about me you don't know, Margot.
Well, I am certainly not gonna bother to find out about it now.
If you want to change your clothes, I brought these for you.
You thought of everything, didn't you? How long have you been planning this?
Not long. Ever since I realized that if I really loved you, I couldn't just wait around till somebody else brought you to your senses. I had to do it.
Love? You call this love?
They say crickets rub their legs together when they're in love. I guess it's all the way you look at it.
How much did you pay Rourke for this little fantasy of yours?
$10,000.
$10,000? Where did you ever get that kind of money?
You forget you pay me well.
Well, I hope you won't feel cheated if I don't change in front of you. Crickets. Look, I'm really tired of this. Why don't you take another path and leave me alone?
Because I know the outdoors better than you do.
I'm sure you do, but I don't need your help. I'll be leaving you now, Benson. That man down there will be glad to take me back to the village. Not because I need him, but because I can pay him.
Well, I'll go with you then.
Not on your life.
I just want to see if you're safe, that's all.
Afraid, Benson? Afraid you can't get back without me? Looks like you and your friend Rourke slipped up this time. Your fantasy is over, Benson. I hope you enjoyed it. My way through this lousy jungle. Do you speak English? I'm trying to get back to the village, to the plane. I can pay you if you'll take me there. I'm sorry, what? I don't understand. How did I get here? It's a long story. A man brought me here. Oh, don't worry, he won't bother us. I left him behind. $100 if you'll take me back to the plane. The lagoon. To Rourke's main house. 200. I've got to get back to that plane now. How much do you want? You can name your price. $1,000. $2,000.
What are you doing? Let me go! You don't understand! I'll pay you!
I'll pay...
Benson!
You play beautifully, Carol.
You've got to be a lot better than that to be a professional.
You will be if that's what you really want to be. You've got a natural talent.
It's just sometimes I wonder, if I really do have a natural talent, where I got it. I mean, I wonder if my real parents are musical. Wouldn't someone else like to play?
Oh, I haven't played for years. I wish I'd kept it up.
Anne, do you have any special talents?
I like to draw. I did all the posters for the school play last Christmas.
Really?
You're lucky, you and Carol. You know what I inherited from my real parents? Nothing.
Well, that's not true, Pat. You're healthy, you're intelligent, you're full of spirit.
It's only because Mom and Dad brought me up that way. It gives me the heaves just to think about my real parents.
Pat? Why?
I saw a girl in the bus station last summer. She was going to have a baby any minute. She was all dirty, she was drunk. I thought, yuck, I'll bet that's what my mother was like.
You shouldn't say that. Well, you shouldn't think it. You don't know anything about...
She gave me away, didn't she? She had me, and then she didn't want me. She probably got paid for giving me away.
Oh, no, I'm sure she didn't.
People do. They get thousands of dollars for a baby. I've read about it in lots of magazines and stuff.
Your mother probably hated having to give you up.
Then why did she?
Well, when people are young and they haven't any money, sometimes they feel trapped. They don't see how they can take on the responsibility of a child. They don't think they could give her all the things someone else could.
They could have lots of reasons. Sometimes when I hear a marvelous pianist playing, I think maybe she's my mother. She had to give me up for her career.
That's the way I feel. Kind of sorry for them. I know they'd have kept me if they could.
Of course they would.
I just hope I never meet mine, that's all.
Look at me. It had to be a dream.
Come on.
Let me show you.
No.
Please. Let me show you.
No.
Please.
Weekend to find out who our daughter is.
Then you know too.
Do you?
I think so.
I think I knew almost at once. But after spending the whole day with them, I'm sure. I mean, it was lots of things, but mostly because she's so much like me. I mean, Anne has all the same feelings I did at her age.
Anne?
Well, of course, Anne.
Oh, no, wait a minute. I mean, I know she's shy, never been away from home before. I can see why you'd feel drawn to her, but...
She feels drawn to me, too. And she doesn't know why.
She's a naturally affectionate child.
Well, I know it's Anne. Well, who do you think it is?
Well, searching for family resemblances. If I had to make a decision right now, I'd say Carol.
Family resemblances? Oh, then it's got to be Anne. Well, look at her eyes.
Look at Carol's hands, her little body. She's just like a miniature you. She's...
What's so funny?
I'm just thinking of a laugh Mr. Rourke must be having right now. We came here looking for our daughter. So far, we've found two.
Thank you.
Mrs., where'd you find her?
Please, you've got to help me. I can't make this man understand. My name is Margot Dean, and I'm an American.
Shut up. Dorf, you crazy bringing her here? What, you and her? All right. You sure nobody followed you? All right, lady. Where are you from? Who are you?
My name is Margot Dean.
I think he wants you to keep quiet and eat.
Does he ever say anything?
He used to. Before he got in a fight in the mainland and one broken whiskey bottle, whoosh. I guess you know why he brought you here. You don't want to share, huh? Not yet, anyways. Dorf, you always were a greedy pig. You better be careful of this one. You better watch her. She ain't like Hota. No, siree, she's an American. And American women are very stupid. They have very stupid ideas. It's kind of like breaking a horse, you see. I mean, some are wilder and more difficult. But in the end, you break them. The horse does what you want.
Trying to protect my man. Take Hata's bunk.
What happened to Hata?
She ran away?
She tried once. But the dogs found her. Raoul and Dorf brought her back. After that, she stayed and worked. She was a good diver. She made a mistake, though. I think she went too deep.
What do you mean? What was she diving for?
Pearls. That's why we're on this island.
How long have you been here?
2 years. Maybe 3.
There must be some way you could run away. All you need is a head start.
Hey, I don't want to run away.
They're sick. They're crazy.
It's not bad here. There's plenty of food. Raoul is good to me. If I come up with a big pearl, you give me some rum and we have a party. You know what?
I can imagine.
It's really not bad. You'll like it.
The hell I will. I'm getting out. It may take a little while, but I'll get out. Which way is the lagoon?
If you try to get out, I'll call the man.
How much do you want to keep quiet?
I don't need any money. Raoul gives me everything I need.
Please help me.
You sound just like Hoda. You know, After she tried to run away and they brought her back, she got used to it. She liked it. You know, she liked it when her man was good to her. After a while, you feel just the same way. Dorf may not be able to talk, but he's lots of men.
If that animal ever touches me, I'll kill him.
Maybe. Maybe you try it, and maybe you'll like it.
My favorite, especially David Copperfield and Jack London. I like him too, especially his stories about the South Seas.
I used to read Dickens when I was your age, and Hawthorne. I'll send you some of his books.
I'd only written once before I came here. Don't tell Pat, okay?
No, of course not. Well, you're doing just fine.
Maybe when I get home, Dad'll let me have writing lessons. Does it cost a lot?
No, I could. Do you think if I came up to Sacramento, your parents would let you go riding with me?
Sure, why not?
Slow down, Karen. Slow down, come on.
Don't worry, I won't pull off. You're worse than my dad.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm afraid I am. Come on, let's get back to the house. I'm getting hungry.
Take me back to the lagoon, to Rourke's main house. I'll pay you $5,000.
You're gonna spend a great chunk of the rest of your life with us, that is, until we get tired of you.
Like hell I am!
You don't wanna play, huh? It's just like I was telling Dorf, you American ladies, you gotta be broken. Old Dorf. He is gonna be mad as a hornet that he passed out before you two had your honeymoon night last night. Don't matter none, though. You'll be here, pretty and nice, when Dorf wakes up. Hmm? Me and Keto are going diving.
You can't leave me here, please!
Thank you.
I swear, I never knew. I swear.
Will you just shut up? Let's get out of here.
Get away?
Shall we send the dogs after them?
No. No, let them go. I think our little charade has served its purpose. You did well, both of you. Very well. Now go home. Go home to your kids and give them all a big kiss for me, will you? Ciao.
Ciao.
Who's that girl?
You. You were 12 that summer.
Who's that with me?
Me. I used to come over and play tennis with you.
Where?
Near here. You had a big house on the shore. You came there every year with your mother.
Telephone for Mr. Charles.
If it's Mr. Rourke, tell him I've gone out.
He said it was very urgent, sir.
I won't be a moment, darling.
Rourke,
Dr. Croydon is here. He flew in this morning. He wants to see you. No, at once.
Janet alone. Can Croydon come here?
Dr. Croydon doesn't want Janet to see him, Mr. Fleming. I've already sent a car for you. Sorry, Tattoo.
Boardwalk. How come you always land on boardwalk?
Just luck of the dice, I guess.
117 game in a row. That's a lot of luck.
Come in. Ah, Mr. Fleming. Thank you for coming. Sit down, please.
Where's Dr. Croydon?
You must forgive me. I'm afraid that it's just Tattoo and myself.
I should have known you were lying.
Mr. Fleming, I'm afraid I can't allow you to leave yet. There will be no car to take you back to the house until I give the word. Sit down, please.
But Janet's alone out there.
Not quite alone. Mr. and Mrs. Grant are with her. And, Pierre.
Yes, Pierre. I know you think that I'm responsible for what happened to Janet, but suppose for once in your life, Rourke, you're wrong, and it wasn't me. What if it was Pierre? Has it occurred to you that whoever hated Janet enough to terrorize her into a nervous breakdown 4 years ago may kill her this time?
Mr. Fleming, everything has occurred to me. Believe me. Including the fact that you left your wife alone 4 years ago for 2 hours. Where did you go?
I had some errands.
Errands? You went to the police station in town. They called you the night before and told you they wanted to see you, true?
Yes, yes, yes. But it had nothing to do with Janet.
No, not directly. A detective had flown out from Chicago. He wanted to talk to you about your ex-fiancée, Rosemary. He showed you this. It's addressed to you. Police in Chicago found it attached to the mirror in her bedroom. Oh, I expect it's pretty much the same as the letter in your pocket. May I see it, please? Please. Thank you. Almost word for word. I know you don't believe I can't live without you, Charles, but it's true.
It wouldn't have made any difference if I had taken it seriously. It was too late when I got it.
I see. Is that what you told the police?
That was the truth, and they believed me.
Oh, and I believe you, Mr. Fleming. Oh, I believe you. But it does seem curious that the women you love seem to come to such tragic ends.
Mr. Rourke, I want to go back to Janet.
4 years ago, you told the police it was 2 hours before you got back to the house, Mr. Fleming. It will be 2 hours this time. Tattoo will keep you company.
Do you like Monopoly?
What?
Tell me,
just what is your Mr. Rourke?
Some people call him. And some people call him.
And what do you call him?
Mr. Rourke.
I can't find any cut.
Pierre, I remember you. You were always there when I needed you. You always let me do everything myself. I remember when I was 12 years old, you taught me how to sail. And then I almost capsized the boat, but you were there. And you took the tiller and set the sail right again.
I didn't think you'd remember that.
I know, why? Why do I remember you when I've forgotten almost everything else?
What else do you remember about me? Don't. You were just 16 that summer. But the next year, when you came back to the shore, the next year, you hardly knew I was alive, either of you. I was just that French-Canadian kid who looked after the boat.
Don't look at me like that as though you hated me.
I did hate you. You and Charles. Watching you walk off along the beach together. Seeing you all dressed up for him. Going to a dance at the country club.
It's happening. Everything's happening all over again.
Oh. Window, window.
I've been looking every place for you, Mrs. Fleming. I think you should change your dress before Mr. Charles comes home.
Do you know Santa Barbara?
No.
Oh, it's a fun place for children. There are lots of beaches and marina. Do you ever go sailing?
Uh-uh.
Well, maybe when we get back, you can come down and spend the weekend with us.
Could Mom and Dad come too?
Sure. I'd love to meet them.
Yeah. Mrs. Faber.
Carol!
Carol, what is it?
It's Pat. She swam out around the corner. The tide's awful strong.
Well, isn't Mr. Faber with her?
He's trying to find her. He told me to come back.
And you get her under the fire and get her dry. And stay there.
Starting to breathe. She's gone.
Like an old line shack.
I don't think we should try those mountains in the dark. So it looks like about the safest place to spend the night.
Dorf and Rollo are still following us.
Well, we'll just have to do the best we can. Come on.
Sorry about the accommodations, but I'm sure you can manage. You've done very well, up to now.
Mr. Rourke has a rather warped sense of humor.
Not exactly the comforts of home.
It's freezing.
Look at the fire started.
No!
Oh! Ah!
darling.
No, I can't tell you. You won't believe me.
I will believe you. Of course I will. Just tell me. What is it? What happened?
No, I'll show you. Come here. Look in the bed. Look under the pillow.
There was a machete there.
Right there. I saw it. But I didn't imagine it either. And I didn't imagine all those other things.
Come on, in the cottage. I'll show you. Come on. Come on. We broke those shutters.
All right. All right, darling. I believe you. I do believe you.
No, you don't.
Look.
You think it's all in my mind.
I believe everything.
Pierre saw it.
Martini on the rocks and a New York steak rare, please, waiter.
You can have anything you want tomorrow.
Thanks. Some fantasy you dreamed up. More like a nightmare.
Well, I guess on this island, you have to take the consequences for your fantasies.
Oh, that's fine for you. But if you'll remember, this is your fantasy. It's not mine. You tricked me here.
Okay, you just keep reminding me, Margot, and I'll just keep apologizing.
You shouldn't have rescued me from those two animals. You should have joined them. You would have loved it. A woman to cook and work and take orders from you. That's your dream, isn't it? A good drunken romance every Saturday night. Isn't it part of your fantasy to seduce your boss?
I wouldn't know. I mean, you're not my boss anymore. You fired me, remember?
Oh, you better believe I remember, Benson.
You must be feeling better. You didn't call me Benson for hours.
Why don't you answer my question?
Okay, sure. I'd like to seduce my boss. But on the other hand, did it ever occur to you that I might be in love with you?
It occurs to me that I am very tired.
I thought women started saying that after the wedding.
You're a scream. You're bleeding.
It's all right. Do you realize that you finally called me Lowell?
Where did you get a silly name like that?
It's an old New England name.
Lowell, Massachusetts? Is that where you're from?
Boston.
Proper Bostonian.
Some of the time.
Well, we're a long way from Beacon Street. Share this with me if you want.
No, I think I'll better sit up and tend to the fire.
Afraid I might try to seduce you, Benson?
Now that would really be a fantasy. Janet!
Miss Grant, have you seen Janet?
No, sir. Isn't she in her room?
No, she's not. I've looked all over the grounds upstairs.
key for this?
No, sir.
Grant.
Grant! Grant!
Howdy, sir.
The key to the cellar, please.
I've never seen one. That door hasn't been open in years. Perhaps Pierre could force the lock.
Well, have you seen my wife?
Yes, sir, about an hour ago, out in the patio.
We'll get some flashlights, quick. Hurry!
Yes, sir.
Mrs. Fleming! Mrs. Fleming! Oh, Mrs. Fleming! Mrs. Fleming, she's over there in the water. She's drowned herself.
Show me what you thought you saw.
She's in the water.
Easy now, easy.
She's right there.
Now look, there's nothing there. Absolutely nothing. You must have seen a reflection or something.
Where is she then?
Hi.
Where is Miss Janet?
No, no, now come on back to the
house. Simon.
The doctor. There's nothing to worry about. She's a strong, healthy girl. Lucy, is something wrong?
No. Just that you were right about Anne. She's not the one.
And you think you know who is?
I knew that horrible moment when you tried to revive Pat and she didn't respond. I couldn't feel as deeply as that about anyone except our own child.
See, any child
Brian,
in that situation.
Would you listen to me? When she started to revive, when she moved, I kept remembering the moment she was born. It was like I was living through it all over again.
You can't remember her birth, darling. You almost died.
I'm not giving her up again. I just can't. I'm gonna tell her.
You can't.
I have to. Don't you see? I can't let her go through life thinking her mother was some kind of a tramp like that girl in the bus station. She's got to know the truth.
Lucy, it'll only hurt her. It'll only hurt you.
It'll give her a whole new confidence in herself. If she knows that her parents are decent people who care about her, who love her, she'll be so much happier.
She's happy now. Despising her real parents, that's only her way of coming to terms with the fact that they gave her away. It only makes it possible for her to love her adoptive parents even more.
It's time for her to choose for herself.
She didn't have a choice before. We made it for her. She's not looking for a second chance, Lucy. You are. Now, can't you see how unfair that is?
Mrs. Faber. Mrs. Faber.
Lucy, you can't tell her.
I am going to.
No.
Now, leave me alone.
Even if it is the truth. If it is, Pat, she'll be torn between you and the only mother she knows. We haven't got the right to do that to any child.
Could I have some more milk?
Yes. Sure, darling, of course. Now, you go back to bed. I'll bring it to you, okay?
Listen, what happened this afternoon? I didn't mean to swim out so far, honestly. It was the tide. Well, what I mean is, do Mom and Dad have to know? They'd be worried sick every time I went anywhere. You know what parents are like.
Yes. Yes, we know.
It's bad enough now. Can't even leave the house without letting them know where I'll be every second.
They must love you very much.
To tell you the truth, me too. I miss them already.
Well, I don't see why they have to be told. I mean, it was just an accident. But we can all forget about it and just be happy you're safe.
Thanks.
Good night, sweetheart.
Sit there with her. Sit close beside her. She'll regain consciousness in a minute. Well,
is there anything I should do or say, Dr. Croyd?
Well, just hold her close, reassure her. Charles, this is the important moment. This is the crucial moment. It wasn't terror that made her close her mind 4 years ago. It was guilt. She thought she had killed you. Now, if you're the first person she sees when she opens her eyes now, if she knows who you are.
Yes, I understand, Doctor.
She wakes up. Charles, take her away from here, right away from the past. You have your whole future together ahead of you now.
Oh, I'll stay right beside her, Doctor.
I'm afraid I need you, Mr. Fleming. Oh, it won't take long. Dr. Croydon will stay with Janet until you get back. All right? This way, please.
Doctor.
Tricks.
This time she's really killed him.
But we had nothing to do with it. Nothing to be blamed for this time.
We're still to blame for what we did to that poor girl 4 years ago. And now Mr. Charles is dead.
Deserves to be dead. He's to be blamed for our daughter killing herself.
Rosemary, was you a daughter?
Tricks. You should be dead.
No, Simon! No! Let him go!
You're as guilty as if you had murdered Rosemary.
Rosemary, their daughter? It can't be. I don't see how.
Mr. Fleming. She was 8 years old when you went off to school and 10 years old after you went into the Navy and then to college, and she loved you all that time.
Yes, but why didn't she tell me who she was?
Well, she was afraid. I guess she was afraid you wouldn't think her good enough if you knew she was the servant's daughter.
This is all crazy.
She was a child, Mr. Fleming. A child with a chance to marry the prince in the magic castle, don't you see?
How they must have hated me. Their daughter had just killed herself because of me, and I was bringing Janet here on our honeymoon. If only they had taken out their revenge on me instead of Janet.
Last lap.
Terrific. Now all we have to do is climb Matterhorn.
I don't think so. If I remember correctly, Rourke said there was a tunnel through these mountains. It's over there. Come on. One of those should lead to the other side.
The question is, which one? Come on.
Wait a minute. Draft. It could be a dead end.
Well, it might be and it might not. I'll take that one and you take this one. Let me take the flashlight.
You're the boss.
Thank you.
please thee. Aren't you?
Am I?
Well, you did find the way out, and the main house is just down the hill. That is, if you're really sure you want to find your way back to civilization. Just yet.
Benson?
Well, I see you found the way out.
She's coming back to get you.
Looks like my fantasy's over.
Maybe.
Miss Lee, welcome back to civilization.
Thank you, Mr. Rowe. I'm not certain what for, but thank you.
You have an appointment with Mr. Roy Maxwell in New York next week.
Who arranged this?
A small return for the trick I played on you. Although, somehow, I have the feeling you're no longer angry about that.
Well, I think probably we should go.
No, I have a little business matter to settle with you first. I thought Mr. Rourke might like to witness it.
$5,000? Oh, it's my severance pay.
It's not your severance pay. That is my half of the $10,000 you paid for this weekend.
Well, I guess I'm not fired after all.
Not on your life. I'm not going to let you run away from me now. You started something this weekend. I don't know where it'll lead us, but I'm damn well going to find out.
The plane is ready.
Goodbye, Mr. Rourke. Thank you for a very interesting experience.
And a very interesting start.
Thank you.
Shall we go?
What did Mr. Benson start?
He didn't start anything, Tatu. It's as old as time. A man and a woman, different and the same, equal and unequal. Doomed to go on loving and fighting each other as long as they live.
What do they have to fight about?
They're fighting for equality, Tatu. I wonder if they'll recognize it. If they ever find it. Come.
Anniversary.
They will have many more tattoos, but like this one, never.
It is Pat, isn't it?
Not Carol. Not Anne.
I just wish they were all mine.
That's all that matters, Mrs. Fay. That's all that really matters.
No, you're right.
Life is a series of exchanges. Maybe we're ready for one now.
We are delighted.
Thank you.
You are most welcome.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, Miss Fader.
Bye-bye.
Which one was their daughter? Pat, Carol, or Anne?
No questions on Fantasy Island, at all. Mr. and Mrs. Fader came here. They had no children. Now they have three.